Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Reaper Reborn by Kel Carpenter and Meg Anne. Narrated by Hollie Jackson. I'm Death, and I make sure that everyone is equal. The Brothers Grimm. Chapter 1. Hunted. What the actual fuck? My heart beat in erratic rhythms as my doppelganger lifted a Ray-Bans and my own gray eyes stared back. I wish I had something clever to say. I'd like to think that I could handle this craziness with the same laissez-faire attitude I approached life with. But let's be real. This is me we're talking about. Hammer meet nail. Who the fuck are you? I demanded, crossing my arms over my chest. My name is Thana, she said, striding forward with a sleek gait. Daughter of Death. It was eerie to see my own body move with the litheness of a predator. My eyebrows drew together as my thoughts started whirring. There was a moment there where I heard her words, but they didn't really compute with my short-circuiting brain. I was either in shock or having a seizure. Judging by the continued stream of consciousness, shock was winning, though I wasn't willing to rule anything out just yet. But I'm the daughter of death, I started. For some reason, it was the daughter of death comment that snagged my attention the most. While I didn't even know what it meant to be one, I was already territorial of my title. I mean, I did just save, like, all the Reapers from death. Being a soup freak was now my shtick. I didn't know who this gray-haired broad was, but until I did, I was going to pull one from Esme's book. Stick to my guns. Or, in this case, my foul mouth and charming personality. And my sister, she said, finishing my sentence, though not the way I would have expected. My twin. Her gaze drifted over my shoulder to where Shepard's ghost was hovering. She gave him a pointed look before looking to me once more. I don't understand, I said slowly. I don't have a sister. Even if I did have a doppelganger. Weird. Next level kind of weird. Like some Twilight Zone shit. You did, she said, but it came out closer to a purr. She leaned forward and lifted one of my pale pink locks, twirling it in her finger. Before you were reborn. Up to that point, time was moving slower for me. My thoughts were tripping over one another, trying to come up with who the fuck this girl was. I mean, she looked like me, she dressed like me, and if it weren't for her corporeal form, I might have thought I was hallucinating. Maybe I accidentally split a piece of my soul, just like James. But here she was, a second version of myself standing in the flesh. The idea of having another twin seemed crazy, until you remembered the little tiny fact that, apparently, I reincarnated. Was it possible that a past version of me wasn't just me? I looked at Shep. You're seeing this too, right? Some of the seriousness drained from my brother's face as he gave me an annoyed twist of his lips, followed by a very dramatic sigh. Yes, Salem, I can see her too. Just checking, I muttered. Sheesh. You'd think for being dead he'd be less irritable since I was going to bring him back, fucker. Least I wasn't hallucinating. That much was clear. I can assure you, I'm quite real, Salem. I know this is probably a shock to you, and you've always been a bit unpredictable when given surprises, but there's no other way to really say this. She took a deep breath, and all I could think about was the fact that this was not how I planned to spend my morning. I was starting to wish I'd never left the pool house, which was crazy, because you'd think that I would want to know if I had a twin running around, right? Well, that was probably the shock. Hostess cupcakes were really good at getting someone over shock, though. You and I were the original daughters of death in this realm, Thana announced, putting an end to my meandering. Her next words were an icy bucket of water over my head. We created the Reapers, We maintain the order in the supernatural world, you and I. I opened and closed my mouth, eventually settling on the most important and obvious questions. What happened then? I asked. Why was I killed? How was I killed? A monster. Her eyes flashed with cold fury. I felt the chill from it deep inside. A monster? I repeated, not letting my unease show. I used my dubious tone of voice and narrowed my eyes. From the realm of death, she said. It's been hunting us. After your first death, we were separated, and it took many years to find you. By then, it was too late. You died again. This happened several times along the way, but I've found you now. Her words trailed off as she released the lock of hair and cupped my cheek. We'll be together again. I've grown over the centuries. My power has grown. I can keep you safe where others cannot. Her skin was cool to the touch, her expression genuine, sincere. How did you find me? Death, she said simply. I felt your presence enter the spirit realm. There's only one person who is my equal in everything. I knew it was you. Well, that seemed to make sense, as much as any of this did. It was a lot to take in, though. Something niggled in the back of my brain, like she wasn't telling me the complete truth. You've been in town for a little while now, I said, shaking off her hand. She had no outward reaction. No surprise, no hurt at my movement, nothing. The inhumanness of her reactions, the way she oscillated from sincere to cold so rapidly, it was more than unsettling. I needed to assess the danger. She gave me a sad look then, one corner of her mouth curving down. The monster is a clever beast. It hides in those you know. I needed to interact with them as you so that I could see if it's already found you. And? I prompted slowly, watching carefully. Has it? It's on your trail, but I don't believe it's infiltrated those close to you yet. It took out the witch you were talking to because she knew too much. Her eyes slid sideways once more to where Shepard still wavered. You should be careful interacting with ghosts too much. They work with the monster, spy for it. You shouldn't trust anyone. Anyone but you? I said. It was only a moment, but a flash of annoyance crossed her features as she realized how that sounded. The more my shock at seeing her wore off, the more I was coming back to my senses. Well, she started, but I cut her off. You seem to know an awful lot about this monster, and yet it's me that's died multiple times. I put my hands on my hips, my suspicion mounting. I know a great deal because we're the ones that created it. I blinked twice. Now that I was not expecting. Before I could gather my thoughts and come up with a response, Thana continued talking. We created it together and unleashed it upon the world. Something soured in it along the way. It wanted power for itself, so it turned on us. I wanted to put it down, but you thought you could save it. She smiled again, but it wasn't happy. It was almost pitying, but with a hint of warmth. You always were so soft. I let out a snort of derisive amusement. Yeah, right. Warm and fuzzy, I am not. Anyone who knows me will tell you I'm about the furthest thing from soft that you can be. Thana studied me, her gray eyes cool and assessing. There was a detached calculation there that I didn't recognize. Had I ever looked at anyone the way she's looking at me? Instead of replying, she lifted her right shoulder in a bored shrug I definitely recognized. It was beyond creepy how her mannerisms were so like mine, and yet it was like meeting an alien. She possessed an otherness about her that I wasn't sure what to do with. Was I supposed to trust her? Hardly. I knew almost instantly that wasn't happening anytime soon. I'd lost too many people to trust someone that shared my face, showing up in town right after Darla was murdered. She claimed it was a monster, and her explanation sounded good. Almost a little too good, though. She may be who she claimed, but something told me I didn't have the full picture. And really, how could I? She claimed we'd been here since the beginning of time, basically. There were a lot of questions to ask and a lot of ground to cover before she got anything resembling trust. I glanced over my shoulder at Chip, wondering what he was thinking about this turn of events. His body was tense, but his face was unreadable, giving nothing away. That, in itself, was telling. Shep didn't trust the bitch either. But was it because she was claiming his title, or for another reason? Until I dealt with Thana and got Shep alone, it was clear I was not going to solve that riddle. As enlightening as this is, I was sort of in the middle of something with my actual twin, so how about you schedule something with my assistant and we continue this conversation another time? There. That was subtle. Sort of. Thana frowned, looking entirely too disappointed with me.
I know this isn't easy for you to believe after everything that's been happening around here, but you need to listen to me. You're in danger, and the only one who can keep you safe is me.
I've been doing just fine on my own, I said, my voice hard this time. That was a bit of a stretch. I died, what, 4 times now? 5? Not a great track record, unless you considered the part where I came back each time more powerful than before. That was pretty cool. The look in her eyes shifted then, almost like she'd decided to try a different tact with me, because the whole your life is in danger thing clearly wasn't working like she'd planned.
Salem, she said, reaching for my hand.
Energy tingled through me at the touch, and once again, I stepped out of her reach. Her expression turned mournful.
I have walked this realm alone for almost 4 centuries, searching for you, trying to save you, only to be too late every time. You are my sister, the only one who is my true equal. Don't you see? We need each other. It's the only way we can defeat this monster.
There was an earnest sincerity in her voice that had been lacking until now. I wasn't sure how to feel about it, but it was obvious to me that Thana truly believed what she was saying. Then again, James had believed in what he was doing too. Belief didn't make someone trustworthy.
Look, I sighed. I have a lot going on right now. This whole monster business is just icing on the cake, and while you may be my long-lost twin, I have a brother I'm trying to save because he's the twin I know. I'm not asking you to run away with me. I know you too well to think that would ever happen. I just want to be a part of your life again, she said softly.
Indecision warred within me, but one thing was clear. This chick had answers. Answers about who and what I was. I couldn't completely blow her off, not yet. And really, I wasn't sure if I wanted to. While I didn't trust her at all, I did get the distinct impression she felt attached to me. There was a kinship of sorts. It couldn't hurt to listen and see how this played out. I'd lost a lot of people lately. My eyes strayed to the spot where my father had been before he disappeared. Maybe I could gain some too. I don't trust you, I told her. Disappointment flashed through her expression as her lips pressed together and the corners of her eyes tightened.
I can't change that until you let me.
I know. I crossed my arms over my chest as I regarded her. A pang went through me, something I didn't understand, but I wanted to. Here's the deal. I'm interested in staying alive instead of starting all over again. Teach me what we are, how to control my powers, and how to defeat the monster. I want to know everything, the good, the bad, and the ugly.
That's not something you can learn overnight, she said.
If it were, I'd be gravely disappointed in the universe for giving me something that easy for once, I replied in a bland tone. She snorted, grinning over at me.
I suppose there is that, she said, coming closer once more. You know, you have no memory of me. You don't know how much we've been through yet. Even after all this time, though, you're still the same.
Don't be so sure, I said, pulling away. We might have the same face, the same origin, a shared history, but I don't remember it. In this life, I am Salem. I had a twin brother. My best friend is a succubus, and my boyfriend is a reaper. You may have been around a while pretending to be me, but you don't really know me.
No, she said softly, stepping up beside me. but I will. My phone dinged in my pocket. I pulled it out and read the text from Graves. Where are you going? She asked, following after me as I started walking toward the parking lot. The council called a meeting. Every supernatural in Pharaoh's Square has to be there. Cool fingers brushed my arm. I glanced over my shoulder. But you're not a supernatural, she said. Yeah, but they don't know that. I considered that for a moment as I resumed walking. Well, most of them. The Reapers have some inkling. Pausing, I called out, Shep? He popped up in front of me.
Yeah?
Meet me at the morgue tonight. We're going to find you a body. His gaze slid sideways toward Thana. He clearly didn't trust her, but he kept those thoughts to himself for the moment as he nodded once, then disappeared. He doesn't care for me, she noted in a shrewd voice. You just barged in and claimed to be my long-lost twin from another life. He's skeptical, I said, making my way to the car once more. Reasonably so. Reaching the Impala, I flung the door open and hopped in. On the other side of me, Thana did the same. What are you doing? I asked her. Coming with you, she answered like it was obvious. You can't come to a council meeting. Why not? I put on my own pair of Ray-Bans and started the car up. Because they don't know you and they don't know what I am. And I'm trying to keep it that way. She squinted at me. Why? Because, I reached for words, because they can't know. That's a dumb reason, she said. Hey, you're the one that just said a monster is hunting me, I argued. Yes, she agreed with an emphatic nod, her tone of voice sarcastic. The supernatural's knowing what you are won't make a difference. The monster will find us in the end. It always does. In the meantime, I'd like to stay close to you. I know you don't trust me, but I want to make sure you're safe. I put the car in reverse as I considered her words. The fact of the matter was, I didn't really want to let her out of my sight either, but I was pretty confident strolling into a council meeting with a surprise twin from a past life was not going to do me any favors. I had more than enough on my plate without having to try and explain Thana's presence as well. How about this? I said, eyeing her as the car started moving. Why don't you hang out with my aunt while I take care of the Reaper business? Then when I get back, you and I can have that heart to heart. I could see the desire to debate the point with me. It was written all over her face. It was a look I knew because I wore it all the time. It was the same battle that was constantly raging inside of me. The need to argue, to prove that my way was right. I let out a little breath. Stubborn people were a real pain in the ass. This must be what Graves deals with whenever he's trying to convince me to just listen to him. The thought brought a small smile to my face and I shook my head. Listen, I know you don't like this plan, but this is the way it needs to be. Regardless of your stance on the Reapers and supernaturals in general, things are tenuous right now. Let's not throw the Daughter of Death grenade into the mix just yet, okay? Not until I've had a chance to wrap my head around it myself. Thana fell quiet beside me, her arms crossed over her chest. Fine, she agreed, blowing out a breath of her own. Oh, Esme was going to love this. We only just got rid of one hostage for her to keep an eye on, and I was already bringing home a second. My eyes slid to Thana. Not that she knew that was the real reason for my suggestion. Let her believe whatever she wanted. Esme and her trusty machete would watch this girl like a hawk. I sped down Mansion Lane, pulling up the drive to my house in less than 5 minutes. Graves was already waiting outside, his eyes widening slightly as he noticed the figure seated next to me in the Impala. Killing the ignition, I popped out of the car. Graves, there's someone I'd like you to meet. His eyes narrowed on me.
I thought you said you were at the cemetery.
I was. Graves pressed his lips together and eyed Thana, who was out of the car and leaning against the passenger door.
This some kind of fucking joke?
He asked, looking between us. I let out a humorless laugh. Not unless the joke's on me. Graves, meet my... I paused to look at Thana. What did you call yourself? My true twin? She eyed Graves shrewdly and gave a single nod. The mistrust was evident in the hard lines of Graves' face. This introduction was going to get ugly fast if I didn't play this right. Thana has been looking for me. She says she's here to help me deal with whatever's hunting me and to learn more about my powers. I'm going to have her keep Esme company until we get back from the council meeting and have a chance to chat more. While I was talking, I was staring hard at Graves, communicating with my eyes everything I couldn't say out loud. Trust me. Go with this. We can talk about everything when we're alone. His expression was still hard, but he gave a slow nod.
Your name is Thana? He asked.
She lifted an eyebrow, her expression one of utter condescension. She didn't stutter, Thana said. Graves didn't wilt under her tone as he said,
Thana means death.
A cold smile curled around her lips. I am a daughter of death, just like Salem. He turned, angling his body away from her and toward me.
Can we talk?
On the way to the council meeting. You said it was starting soon, and I don't think your dad will appreciate us being late, I said, moving past him. He grabbed my forearm, making me pause.
Salem.
Later, I said softly, a promise in my voice. Our eyes met, and his burned with questions. Heat stirred in my veins as his grip loosened, sliding down my arm as I stepped toward the door.
All right.
He squeezed my hand once and let it go. I flung the front door open. Esme? I only had to call out once. Esme came around the corner wielding a scythe. She spun it around in a showy maneuver, but when her eyes fell on Thana, her grip slipped. The scythe slid sideways a foot before she regained her hold. 6 inches of brown hair streaked with gray fell on the floor. Who's this? She asked, holding the weapon in one hand as she strode forward. Thana, she's... My words trailed as I struggled to find an adequate answer. While Esme had seen me do things other Reapers couldn't do, we'd never gone into the differences, or the small fact that I was just another reincarnation of myself and had lived countless other lives before now. I'm Salem's twin. Thana said, taking it upon herself to speak. Her true twin. Esme narrowed her eyes, her thin lips pressing together. I hate to break it to you, but I was there the day that girl was born. Esme pointed in my direction. She came out with a brother, not a sister. In this life, Thana corrected. In her original life, it was only her and I. You and her brother might be family to this reincarnation. I held my hand up for Thana to stop, because she was not making the situation any better. Okay, look. I let out a sigh. I wasn't completely upfront with you about everything. Right before we brought James back and told you I was a Reaper, we learned that's not quite true. I'm what's called a daughter of death. No, I don't know what all that means yet. Thana here found me at the cemetery this morning, though, and she says we're sisters. Or we were. Esme's eyes were bouncing between Thana and me, a small wrinkle deepening between her brows. We still are, Thana insisted like I wasn't speaking. I shot her a pointed glare, and she gave me the same look right back. Anyways, I drawled, looking away from her. It was just too eerie. There's a lot going on right now, and I have some explaining to do, but the council just called a meeting, and Graves and I can't be late. Should I prepare the basement for our guest? Esme asked, with just enough of a smile it should have been disarming. I recognized the code, however. She wanted to know if Thana was a friend or an enemy. I wish I knew the answer. No, I don't think you guys need to be that formal. Maybe just hang out in the kitchen? Esme's eyes narrowed as she tried to suss out any hidden meaning in my words. I mean, I thought it was pretty obvious. The kitchen is where the knives were. If things went squirrely, Esme wouldn't be caught without a weapon. Graves tapped his foot impatiently beside me.
Salem, we should really get a move on.
Yeah, okay. My eyes darted between Thana and Esme one last time. You two going to be okay? Thana gave me a wide smile. I'm going to enjoy some time getting to know my new family. Esme's expression was harder to translate, but the not-so-subtle shift of her grip on the scythe was unmistakable. We'll be fine. You two run along. I'll just give Thana a tour of my machete collection. Worry sat like a ball of lead in my stomach, but this really was my best option for the moment. I had to trust that Esme could take care of herself and pray that Thana's motives were as pure as she claimed. All right, let's go, I said to Graves, turning back to the door. He was already holding it open. I'd barely put the car into drive when Graves was demanding answers. Spill it. My eyes darted to the rear view, although I wasn't sure what I was expecting to see. We'd only been gone for about 10 seconds. It's exactly like I said. She found me talking to Shep. Claims she's here to help. I didn't have enough time to interrogate her before you were blowing my phone up.
A single text is hardly blowing you up.
I rolled my eyes. It was the subtext of your text.
The subtext?
I nodded, all broody and demanding.
I don't brood.
Sure you don't, Cupcake. Hey, speaking of, are there any still stashed in the glove box? Graves was shaking his head beside me.
You can't just change the subject because you're suddenly hungry.
What? I threw him a cheeky grin. I worked up an appetite last night. His blue eyes smoldered as they met mine, but he didn't give in.
Her timing is too convenient. After all those weird sightings of you. Salem, she looks identical.
Well, duh. I mean, she's my fucking twin, Graves. As for the sightings, I know. Believe me, I haven't overlooked it, but I haven't gotten a chance to properly question her. But her story lined up with Darla's warning. I think she's telling the truth, Graves. But if she really is who she says she is, we have literally thousands of years to discuss it. And given how little we know about what I am, I wasn't passing up my only opportunity to learn. I couldn't let her come with, but I don't trust her enough to leave her alone. This way, we know where she is, and we can get answers as soon as we're done with the council. The muscle in his jaw flexed, but he gave me a terse nod.
I guess it's our only option for the moment.
So do I get that cupcake now?
Just drive, Salem,
he said, sighing. I think I've more than earned it. I did just save every Reaper, and I gave you at least 3 mind-blowing orgasms. A plastic-wrapped treat smacked the side of my face. I was too busy multitasking as I drove and unwrapped it that I didn't even bother to complain that my new boyfriend had just pelted me in the face with my favorite snack. Sometimes a girl had to pick her battles, and somehow, I had a feeling that there were some big ones on the horizon. Chapter 2. Dissension. The council room was packed. People were pressed up against each other like cookies in a box. The air felt hot, stifling, despite the air conditioner running on full blast. It wasn't just the number of people packed into the council's meeting room, though. Tension settled over the crowd. It ran from one person to the next, growing heavier with each silent moment. Graves and I shuffled into the back, trying not to be noticed, given we were tardy. The members of the council sat, gathered around their long table, all except for Alexander, that was. He stood apart from the others with his hands clasped behind his back.
The Reapers have dealt with the problem. The council has passed judgment that the werewolf in question will be given life on parole. He'll live with his pack, but be unable to leave their territory.
Looks like we were more than a little late if they'd already explained most of the situation, at least the version of it they were going by. I highly doubted Alexander was going to tell them all about his own son's involvement. Admitting that James had been a murderer and controlling the poor guy wasn't exactly a great way to instill faith in the Reapers, or their leader.
That doesn't sound very much like a punishment.
A voice rose from the crowd, but I couldn't pick out where it came from. One person was all it took to sow dissent among the mass of supernaturals. After everything that had happened, tensions weren't just running high. They were under incredible strain and threatening to snap entirely.
He killed 3 vampires,
another voice said, coming from the other side of the room. The group right in front of Graves and I shifted uneasily.
And 2 fae, let's not forget that.
A third voice added, coming from the opposite side of the room. I pinpointed this one because she was standing near the front.
Tall and ethereal, her lavender hair was tied to one side, and her pale yellow eyes were narrowed on the council before us.
"I've given harder punishments in the bedroom," a fourth voice shouted.
I recognized it as the Betty Page lookalike I'd met the first time I'd gone to Succubus United, also known as Sigma Upsilon. It was Laura, the dominatrix. That one got a few chuckles from the crowd, but it did nothing to ease the growing unrest.
"That's hardly called for. Sarah Cunningham, Tamsin's mom and the Succubus-Incubus representative on the council, said." Her voice was hard, but judging by the look on her face, I got the impression she didn't disagree.
"And you, Desdemona,"
a distinctly masculine voice called.
"You can stand for this injustice."
The man didn't yell or speak as loudly as the others. On the contrary, his voice was fairly soft. He stepped forward from the crowd of what I'd assumed was vampires, given the distinct resemblance most of them had to both the vampire representative and Gretel, my ghostly Siri. His hair was dark and skin unbelievably pale. There was a red glint to his brown eyes, a hardness of his features that reminded me of marble statues.
"There were special conditions and things in play that you do not know," the vampire representative replied, tapping her blood-red nails along the hard edge of the wooden table. Her expression was cold.
"Such as?" he asked.
"The council decided they will not be disclosed," she replied, her voice quieter still.
I got the distinct impression that, like Tamsin's mom, the lady vamp didn't agree with the ruling. And if not even the council could agree on the punishment, how did they expect the rest of the supernatural community to blindly accept it? Graves and I exchanged uneasy looks as murmurs started to fill the room. The words themselves were indistinguishable, but the anger that laced them was unmistakable.
"This is bullshit,"
someone growled from the back, their anonymity making them bold. A chorus of yas sounded in agreement. My eyes shifted to the council table, falling on the grizzled werewolf representative. Danger was coming off of him in waves. His eyes were narrowed, a soft red glow shining from the depths. His face was flushed, which only served to make the thick scar running down his face more noticeable. I didn't know the guy, but even I could tell he was barely reining in his temper.
"Serafina, how can you allow this?" the lavender-haired beauty questioned.
A woman with dark blue hair rose from her place at the table, her butterfly wings twitching with what I assumed was agitation.
"Rules were broken. The council does not disagree. But a vote was cast, and this is the path that was chosen."
"Notice how she emphasized it was the council's choice?" I whispered to Graves. He nodded.
"The Fae are rarely lenient. Anything less than execution would not appeal to them."
Despite the united front they were presenting, the council was far from unified about this decision. Three of the seven must have fought against the choice. My gut was telling me that didn't bode well for the rest of us. Alexander made an angry sound low in his throat.
"Enough. The decision."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.